Once again, very good morning to all. I hope in the last class we have looked at the concepts of frequency reuse, and then we have looked at cell splitting, and we have started the concept of cell sectorization. Most all these concepts we are using it for improving the capacity of the system. And in today's class, what we will do it is more or less we'll try to review the cell splitting and then cell sectorization concepts, and then we will try to look at some mathematical derivations which are quite useful in understanding the concepts, and we will try to understand the relation between frequency reuse factor, which is we call it as D by R, and then the cluster size. We'll try to establish a relation between these two terms. And then we'll try to look at the mathematical derivation for the propagation in free space. Like if I have a signal, how does it propagate in free space? And what is the mathematical expression at a distance d if I'm trying to consider? If I'm trying to transmit with a transmit power pt, what would be the received power at a distance d? Provided the medium is a free space. This is what we will consider the derivation. And then that we will probably in subsequent classes, we will extend that to a cellular case where the medium is not free space, you have man-made structures and all. So you will have a slight change in the expression that we will try to see it in subsequent classes. Apart from that, we will try to consider the interference part, two types of interference. One is adjacent channel interference, and then other is co-channel interference. And then if time permits, we'll try to solve a problem. Otherwise, we'll try to do that in the next class. Okay. So starting up with cell splitting concept. In the last class, we have seen that to improve the capacity of a particular system, we will try to go for the splitting of a particular cell. And that too, we have to do that in a very graceful manner. Okay. Because generally, when we are trying to establish a particular cellular communication, we'll try to find out the number of users. Depending upon that, we will try to make the number of channels available, or using the concept of frequency reuse and all, we'll try to see to that we are trying to cover all the users present in that particular area. But as the days progress, the number of users within that particular area need not be the same, okay, would be changing. Hence, probably what we may have to do is we may also have to provide more number of channels, or we have to utilize the existing resources efficiently so that we can cover more number of users, or in a way we can improve the capacity of that particular system. For that particular reason, what we do it is in such a cases we'll try to split up these particular cells, and that is what we call it as cell splitting. So we'll try to reduce that particular cell size, and probably what we'll do is we'll try to put up a small base station over here, and the job of this base station is it has to cover only this particular portion. Okay, and so on. So we keep on reducing that particular cell sizes so that what we can achieve is we can go for the number of times the frequency reuse we are making would be increasing. So which in turn improves the capacity of that particular system. Okay, and we have seen these advantages already when we are trying to reduce the cell size. Okay, what we can do is first and foremost thing, the amount of transmission power with which you have to transmit would also be less, and then the antenna height that you have to maintain would also be less. Okay, and the bandwidth that is required would be very less. So that is what we have already seen it. So it reduces the in reducing this particular cell size, we are trying to improve the capacity of that particular system. But the problems that we have seen with the concept of cell splitting is, as you are trying to reduce the cell size, you will have, suppose if I have a user here, if he is moving in this direction, if he is moving in this direction, you can see that is traveling from one cell to another cell. The moment when a person travels from one cell to another cell, the call has to be handed over from this base station to another base station. That is the concept of handoff. So the number of handoffs would be increasing in case of cell splitting. And apart from that, okay, when we are trying to reduce the cell size, when we are trying to reduce the cell size, these two co-channel cells are getting quite closer. Hence, the interference would also be increasing. These are what the problems that we have in the concept of cell splitting. Okay, and this particular concept is used to improve the capacity of the system. Another method, okay, that we have seen, or before getting into that sectorization, the interference part, okay, I hope you have seen this in the last class. This is the cluster, and then I'm trying to repeat that particular cluster. Okay, you can see that the interference portion. Now suppose you can see that this is the co-channel cells corresponding to this are nothing but these things. Now if I'm trying to find out the interference, if I have a mobile handset here, what would be the interference that it is taking up? Okay, you'll get interference from this, as well as from all other portions. So you have six interferers coming and okay interfering with this, the required, the wanted signal power with these unwanted signal powers. That is the interference portion when I'm trying to consider a cluster size of three. Okay, the number of interferers, we are getting it to be six. Similarly, okay, same is the case with n equal to 7. If I'm repeating the cluster size, you can see that again you have, these are what the interferers that I have at this location. And you can see that the distance between these is getting increased. As the distance increases, by the time this signal travels from here to here, okay, this, okay, the strength of that, okay, would be very low. That means interference is becoming very less. Okay, but again, you can see that these are what the interferers we call, and these things we call it as the first tier interferers. Suppose if I'm keep on extending this particular cell structure, probably, okay, you'll get this second tier somewhere here. Okay, and you have in the first tier, you have six. So in the second tier, you'll have 12, and so on. In the third tier, you'll be having 18. But what assumption that we are making, it is from second tier means somewhere here, it is far away from this particular thing. By the time that signal comes here, okay, it, we are assuming that almost we have a negligible amount of power. Hence the, okay, second tier interferers, we are trying to neglect it. Hence we are trying to consider only first tier interferers. Okay, and hence here also what we are having, it is we are having number of interferers equal to six. Now looking at the concept of cell sectorization, which we have already seen it in the last class. Cell sectorization is what we are trying to make, it is instead of using an omnidirectional antenna as in the previous case, which radiates equally in all the directions, what we are trying to do now is we are trying to put up three antennas. Okay, one in this direction, another in this direction, and third one in this direction. What it does is it radiates only in this direction. Okay, so instead of putting an omnidirectional antenna here, now we are trying to put up a directional antennas. Okay, the property of this antenna is it is going to radiate only in this direction. So it is not going to radiate in this direction. So the property of this antenna is it radiates in this, and the property of this antenna is it is going to radiate in this particular direction. So the advantage that you will be having, it is I hope in the previous class when we have solved a particular problem, we have considered the ATL service provider which is having 42 channels F1 to F42, and what we have said, it is for each cell we have considered six channels that are being assigned. Now out of that six channels, what I'm doing, it is 1-2 channel that I'm giving it here, probably 3-4 here and 5-6 here. So in that also I'm trying to make up a division. Now you can see that 1-2 only users present in this particular direction. This antenna is covering that particular thing. Okay. Now because of this directional thing, the interference is getting reduced. Okay. And it need not be only, okay, these three, total 360 degrees that you have. If I'm dividing it into three sectors, 360 degrees divided by three, you will get 120 degrees. So hence I'm trying to put three antennas. One can even go for 360 degrees by 60 or by six. So you can put, okay, every 60 degrees, you'll get a sector. For every 60 degrees, you'll get a sector, but the number of antennas that you require would also be more. Okay, so that is a basic concept of sectorization. And the look at let us look at the interference portion for the sectorization. Now in this case, you can see that I have considered the cluster size equal to 3. Let us assume that this is the cluster that I am trying to consider. And in that also, what we are assuming that, okay, we are assuming that, okay, one set here, second set and third set. Again, I am assuming 120 degree sectorization. So I have three antennas. One is radiating in this direction, this one is radiating in this direction, and this is radiating in this particular direction. Okay. Now what I am trying to do here, it is, if I am trying to look at the interference, because if I am trying to look at three, this one, so these are what we call it as co-channel sectors. Now, what would be the interference that I am getting it? So obviously, as it is a directional antenna, at this point, we are trying to look at the interference. So it is radiating in this direction. It would be radiating in this direction. So hence, I would like to find out what is the interference at this point from rest of them. So you can see that this is radiating in this direction because it is also 120 degrees. So you can see that a portion of that gets radiated into this. So yes, there is some contribution from this. Similarly, from this, it is also radiating in this direction. That means this radiation is in this direction. So this is in the direction of this particular antenna. Hence, an interference comes from this particular portion also. And this also you can see that, okay, this is 120 degrees, it is radiating in this direction. So hence, this also in the direction of this. So these three are contributing somewhat interference at this particular point. But if I'm looking at this one, you can see that it is radiating in this direction, so it cannot come back. So it is radiating in this direction. So there is no interference from this particular sector at this location. Similarly is the case with this. And similarly is the case with this, because these are directional antennas and we'll be radiating in this direction only. Now you can see the amount of interference that we have. In the previous case, at this location, all six first tier interferers were coming and getting interfered with this. So if I'm calculating signal to interference ratio, signal power divided by interference. That interference is I1, I2, I3, I4, I5, I6. Now I4, I5, I6 are becoming zero. We have only number of interferers are only three. So the amount of interference that we have at this portion would be decreasing for us. Okay, that is the advantage that we have when we are going for this particular cell sectorization. Again, the concept of handoff and interference, okay, handoff, you can see that the number of handoffs would be more. Okay, so similarly, if I'm extending the same concept for cluster size n equal to 7, you can see that, I hope this we have seen it in the last class, this is the cluster size n equal to 7, and if I'm trying to look at the interference, okay, again, let's assume that 120 degree sectorization. So only if I'm trying to find out here, then this and this are getting interfering here, and this would not be interfering here. This also would not be interfering. This also would not be interfering. And you can see that this is also is not getting interfered with this. So only two of them you are having it. Okay. So the number of interferers are significantly getting reduced. Suppose if I'm trying to improve the directionality of that particular antenna, instead of making 120 degrees, if I make it as 60 degrees, further you can see that if I'm making it as only 60 degrees, even you will not have contribution from this also. So you'll have only this, only one interference that you have it. Okay, so by improving that particular directionality, still further you can reduce interference, but the problem is you have to have more and more number of directional antennas. Okay, that's what the basic concept of sectorization. So cell splitting put together with cell sectorization, okay, because in cell sectorization we are able to reduce the interference. In cell splitting, as the cells are coming closer, the interference is increasing. That interference can be reduced by the concept of cell sectorization. So these two can be used together to improve the capacity of that particular system. Okay, these are what the concepts that we have seen in the last class. I thought of covering this sectorization more little bit. That is the reason why I took this particular portion. Okay, now considering these things, we'll try to look at some mathematical understandings. Okay, in understanding the concept of basically the frequency reuse factor. Okay, so we are trying to look at relation between frequency reuse factor and cluster size. Reuse factor is D by R. Right, let us try to understand. R is nothing but we are trying to consider the hexagon. Radius of that hexagon, we are trying to consider it to be R. And D is distance between two co-channel cells. In the previous case, if I'm trying to consider, these two are the co-channel cells. Distance between these two cells is nothing but capital D. Okay, that means you are trying to establish a relation between D and R is the radius of this hexagon. R is radius of this hexagon and D is the distance between this. As we said, okay, as we are trying to increase, okay, the cluster size, the distance between these things, okay, is getting increased. The distance between these things is getting increased, okay, and okay, so what would be the impact that we are having it? That's what we'll try to look at it. Okay, so this would be some okay mathematical derivation. Let's try to do it step by step. Okay, so let us consider these are the cell structure that I'm trying to consider. Now what we are trying to say it is this cell is having a radius of R and these two I'm calling it as adjacent cells, or these two I'm calling it as adjacent cells because they are adjacent to each other, and distance between these two, this center to this center, is what I'm calling it as adjacent channel distance. See, this is capital D, this is co-channel distance, and this is adjacent channel distance. This I'll try to represent it by small d. Let's see. Okay, in this okay mathematical analysis, we are assuming that the radius of the hexagon is R, and this okay the size of this each is also R. Okay, the whatever the length of this hexagon, each of them is also having okay a distance of R, and the radius of that is also R. And then this is, we are assuming that okay, this is adjacent okay channel distance because these are adjacent cells. So adjacent cells, okay, from center to center, what is the distance that I am having it? That is what we call it as D. Be careful, capital D and small d. Capital D is distance between two co-channel cells, and small d is distance between two adjacent channels. Okay, adjacent channels is small d, and capital D is distance between two co-channel cells. Okay, and R is the radius of this. Okay, and then what I'm trying to make it is, I'm just trying to okay draw a perpendicular line from the center to this. You can see that, as we said, this is having a length of R, so this would become simply half of that. Okay, and then what I'm trying to do is, I'm trying to join these two. You can see that this is basically what radius of this hexagon. Okay, and this would be capital R. This is basically capital R. Now what I'm trying to do is, I'm trying to consider this particular right angle triangle, because as I'm trying to draw, this is also a perpendicular line from center to center. So here you have okay 90 degrees. Okay, here you have basically 90 degrees. Then hence I'm trying to consider this triangle OA and P. OA is equal to what? Basically R. So if I'm trying to consider this particular triangle, let me take that separately. This is the triangle OAP. Okay, this is the right angle triangle that I'm trying to consider, 90 degrees. Okay, and you can see that this is basically, this is 60 degrees. Hence, obviously, this would be okay 30 degrees. This would be 30 degrees. This is, as it is 90 degrees. Okay, and you can see that in this hexagon, this would be basically 60 degrees. So when this is 60 degrees, so 90, 60, and then you have 130 degrees that you have. Okay. Now what I'm trying to write it is, and I would like to find out the length of this OP. I'd like to find out length OP. Okay, so that once I know this length OP, then I can find out from here to here the length. Okay, now once I get this particular length, then distance D I can find out. So in this scenario, first I'm trying to find out or establish a relation between the adjacent cell distance with the radius. Adjacent, okay, adjacent cell distance with d in terms of r by considering this particular triangle. So now in this triangle, you can write that, okay. Okay, if I am writing sine 60 degrees, which is equal to what? Opposite OP by OA. I'm trying to consider OP by OA, and then I'm just writing OP is equal to what? OA into sine 60, and OA, we know it. OA is nothing but what? Okay, R, and sine 60 is root 3 by 2. So you can see that OP is equal to what? Basically, this OP is equal to what? Root 3 by 2 into R. Okay, so that means this we are trying to find out half of it is, in fact, it is D by 2. And then you can see that D is basically OP, and okay, I hope you need to have Q here. So OP plus PQ, OP plus PQ, that is root 3 by 2 R plus root 3 by 2 R, which is equal to what? Root 3 into R. So this is the first relation that we have, okay, in deriving this D by R and the cluster size. Okay, so let's try to, okay, this mathematics you can do it later, but only thing is try to remember this D, the adjacent, okay, cell distance D is equal to what? Square root of 3 into R, root 3 into R, the relation between this and the radius of hexagon. Okay, D in terms of R is square root of 3 into R. Okay, now keeping this aside, okay, we'll try to look at, now we'll try to get relation for capital D in terms of this small d or probably R. Okay, so that we can club all these things. Now, okay, let me consider relation between D and R. D is basically what? A co-channel, a distance between two co-channel cells. D is nothing but distance between two co-channel cells. And we have already seen how do we identify our co-channel cells in the last class. Okay, that I'll try to quickly look into it, and then we'll try to establish this particular relation. We said, suppose if I wanted to locate my co-channel cell, suppose if this is the cell that I'm trying to consider, and from here, if I wanted to locate, then I have to consider this horizontal axis, and then I have to consider this vertical axis. Move I cells along horizontal axis, and then J cells along vertical axis. Like take 60 degrees counterclockwise, and then move J cells. Then accordingly, you will get your co-channel cell. And the distance between this and this is nothing but what? D, capital D. Okay, this procedure we have seen it in the last class. That I am trying to make use of it now. Okay, so for that reason, what I am doing it is cellular structure I am trying to consider. And this is the horizontal axis I, and this is horizontal, okay, this is axis J axis, vertical axis J. Okay, in the, okay, and you can see that the from here to here, I'm writing it as one unit, because I equal to one here, from here to here. Is that correct or not? We said in the previous class, I have to move I units along this axis. So from this center to this center, and what can I name that? Just now we have derived, it is distance between two adjacent cells. So can I write this as D or not? This is basically D, and this is another D. So anywhere you can consider from here to here. So small d comes into picture here. Okay, this is small d, and capital D is nothing but what? You need to find out, okay, a co-channel cell, and the distance between two co-channel cells is nothing but capital D. First, let us try to find out a co-channel cell. For an example, I equal to 2 and J equal to 1. For I equal to 2, what is that I have to do? Starting from here, for this I am trying to find out co-channel cell. So from this I am trying to start. I am moving one unit and then two units along this axis. Okay, I am moving two units along this axis, and then take 60 degrees counterclockwise and move J equal to 1. So when I am making J equal to 1, I equal to 2, and J equal to 1, you are going to get a, okay, cluster size of 7. This we have seen it in the last class. Now we could see that for this, this is your co-channel cell. So from here to here, whatever the distance that I have is nothing but what? My co-channel cell distance. And this is what I need to find out. Okay, D is the co-channel cell distance. Okay, this is D, and R is nothing but again radius of that particular hexagon. Now this D I am trying to establish from this particular triangle using a cosine formula. Okay, so if I am trying to say that these are points X, Y and Z, I can make use of this cosine formula. Okay, because this angle is 120 degrees. Okay, so I can write XZ square equal to XY square plus YZ square minus XY into YZ into cos of 120 degrees. So where XZ square is nothing but what? Distance D. That is what the mathematical relation that I am writing it. Okay, XZ square. So this XZ square is equal to what? XY square YZ square minus 2 into XY into YZ into cos of 120 degrees. I am just writing the cosine formula here. Okay. Now because of this, now you can see that we have got a mathematical formula for XZ square equal to XY square plus YZ square minus 2 XY YZ cos 120. Out of all these things, you can see that XZ is nothing but the required quantity for us, which is capital D. XZ is capital D, co-channel distance. And XY is what? If I am trying to look at XY, it is along I-axis. Okay. It, in general, along the I-axis, okay, how many units that I am moving? From here to here, D. And from here to here, one more D. That means it is 2D. Because I have assumed I equal to 2. So XY, I can write simply, can I write this as I times D or not? Because this is single unit D and this is one more D. It is 2 times D because in this case, I equal to 2 that we have considered. So more generalization if I'm trying to make XY, I can write it as I into D. Similarly, YZ, I can write it as how many units that I'm moving here? J equal to 1 here. And again, this is the co-channel, this is adjacent channel distance, D. Hence, I can write YZ as J into D. So XY, I can write it as I into D and YZ as J into D. So you have got all those things. Cos 120 also, you know it. So I am writing XZ square is equal to what? XY as I into D, YZ as J into D. In this case, I equal to 2. That means 2 into D. That is the reason why you are here. And J equal to 1. Hence, I am taking one. Okay, XY is I into D, YZ is J into D, cos of 120 degrees. So you can substitute in this. And from this, you can get that particular relation, D square I am taking out. If I am taking D square out, you will get I square here, J square here, and then IJ here. Cos of 120 is minus 1 by 2, so you can get it equal to 2, and that 2 gets cancelled. And you have D square, if I am taking out, capital D square equal to what? Small D square into I square plus J square plus I into J. Okay, this is the relation between capital D and small D. This is the relation between co-channel cell distance and adjacent cell distance. Okay, where I and J are basically integers. Now you can see, now this I can even write it in terms of the R, because D, you know, D, in the previous slide, we have derived root 3 into R. So if I'm substituting that D, it is 3 R square into I square plus J square plus I into J. Okay, I square plus J square plus I into J. And from this, you can derive that relation D by R. D square by R square is equal to what? 3 into I square plus J square plus I into J. Or D by R is equal to square root of 3 into I square plus J square plus I into J. Okay, that's the relation that we are going to, okay, make use of it most of the time. These derivations you need not remember, but try to remember this end results further. Okay, let us try to extend further. We'll try to derive the relation D by R. One relation that we have got it, D by R in terms of IJ. Now let's try to extend that. Okay, so now in this picture, you can see that D is nothing but what? This is a co-channel cell And this is another co-channel cell. So distance between these two cells, co-channel cells, we call it as capital D. Okay. So if I'm keep on, okay, just let us try to add this or, okay, join this co-channel cells from here to here and then from here to here. So what you get it is you are getting one more hexagon here. Okay. So you are getting one more hexagon here with a radius this capital D. So now this is capital hexagon with a radius D. Okay, and you have this is small hexagon with a radius R. Now, what is area of hexagon? Mathematically, area of hexagon, okay, is equal to what? 3 into root 3 by 2 into whatever the radius square. Okay, for this larger hexagon, you can see that for this larger hexagon, okay, we can see that the area of that is 3 into root 3 by 2 into D square, because that is the distance that we have. And then area of small hexagon, let's consider this hexagon. Obviously the same area, but only thing is R square. Okay. Now what I'm trying to write it is, I just wanted to find out what is how many number of hexagon that I have inside this large hexagon. How many number of hexagons that we have inside this large hexagon. Okay. So it is basically this area divided by this area gives me number of hexagons that are present. So I'm just finding out number of cells in this hexagon is nothing but what? This area divided by this area, that is nothing but what? D square by R square. Okay. But apart from that, suppose if I'm trying to calculate it, okay, forgetting about this formula, L is number of cells inside this from this particular formulas. Let us try to find out from this. Okay. So if I'm just trying to count, so is this a cluster A from A to A, B, C, D, E, F, G. So one complete cluster that I have, that is N. And then contribution from this cluster is what? 1/3 of this cluster. Okay. And then 1/3 of this cluster. And then 1/3 of this cluster, 1/3 of this cluster, 1/3 of this cluster, and 1/3 of this cluster. So how many such clusters that I have? 6. 6 into 1 by 3 into n, because 1/3 of each cluster. So you'll get 2n. So total I have n, and then rest of them are 2n. So n plus 2n, that is equal to what? You'll get in general L equal to 3N. So if I'm adding these two, or if I'm equating these two, so you'll get 3N, which is equal to what? D square by R square, or D by R equal to square root of 3 into N, where D by R is nothing but we call it as frequency reuse factor in terms of cluster size. And in fact, you can see D square by R square in the previous slide, we have seen that is equal to what? Square root of 3 into I square plus J square plus I into J. Now when I'm equating, you'll get N equal to I square plus J square plus I into J. This is the thing that we have seen previously. Okay. Derivation for that, we have done it now. When we are doing it, this D by R cluster, okay, frequency reuse factor along with this, okay, cluster size. Okay. So you need not remember these particular derivations, but try to remember this end results. One, the frequency reuse factor. What do you mean by frequency reuse factor? That is D by R, which is equal to what? Square root of 3 into N. And then we have seen the cluster size. All sizes of cluster size are not possible, where I and J has to be integers. Okay. That is another thing that we have considered. I and J must be integers. And this is the cluster size that we are trying to consider. D by R equal to square root of 3 into N. So even in general mathematical calculations also, we'll try to make use of these two formulas. Try to, okay, remember this. And this even you can write in terms of small d also. Okay. So this is relation between the frequency reuse factor and cluster size. Okay. Now we'll try to quickly look at it. Okay, propagation in free space. Okay, like I hope in the previous class we have used, transmission power is inversely proportional to, basically received power at a particular distance is inversely proportional to the distance square. That derivation we are trying to establish now, because that is what is going to, okay, would be useful when we are trying to calculate the path loss of that. So in this scenario, what I am trying to consider, it is I am trying to deploy a base station and it is transmitting with a power of Pt, and it radiates equally in all the directions. It radiates equally in all the directions, and as it is 360 degrees, okay, so this is nothing but sphere. So you are going to get a sphere surrounded by this particular base station. Okay, and then let us assume that the radius of that particular sphere is r. Okay, and then we know that as it is a sphere, the, okay, you have a base station and surrounded by you have a sphere, and the surface area of that sphere is 4 pi into r square with radius r. When you are assuming the radius as r, so the surface area of that particular sphere equal to 4 pi r square. That is one thing that we have. Now what we are trying to do is, okay, we are trying to find out the power intensity at any particular point. What we are assuming that the total power is Pt, which is radiating, okay, surrounded by this base station, and it is radiating equally in all the directions around this particular thing, which is what we are calling it as a sphere, and we are assuming that it is free space, or medium is isotropic. You can call it as isotropic or homogeneous or lossless medium or free space. Free space means what? You do not have any losses. You do not have any losses. That means whatever the power with which I am trying to transmit, by the time it reaches here, would also be same amount of power, because we are assuming that you do not have any losses in between. You do not have any losses in between. So hence, in an ideal case, if Pt is a transmission power with which it is transmitting, so the total power coming out of that sphere, total power that is coming out of this particular sphere, as it equally radiates in all the directions, would be equal to what? Put together, it should be equal to Pt. Total power that is coming out of this is Pt over an area of 4 pi r square. The total power Pt is coming out. Now, as the medium is isotropic or free space that I am trying to consider. Now, what I am trying to do is, as we said, this is completely a sphere, and out of this sphere, I am assuming that, okay, a small portion of area that I am trying to consider. Let us assume that the area of that is 1 meter square. Okay, so now I am trying to find out the total power that is coming out of this area that is equal to 4 pi r square is nothing but Pt. Now, what is the amount of power that is coming out of this small area? That is nothing but, we call it as power intensity. Power intensity is nothing but what? Basically, power coming out per unit area. Power coming out per unit area. You can see that total power that is coming is Pt within the area of 4 pi r square. Total power that is coming out, total power Pt that is coming out of an area of 4 pi r square. So the power coming out of this small area would be what? Pt by 4 pi r square, because this is unit area. Okay, this is unit area. So now what I am trying to say, it is, put together all these things, put together what we are trying to say, it is, if I am trying to transmit with a power of Pt, which is radiating equally in all the directions, as the medium is lossless medium, total power that is coming out of this sphere is Pt. Okay, now I am trying to find out what is the power that is coming out of this small area, which is equal to 1 meter square per unit area. That particular, okay, the power coming out per unit area is what we call it as power intensity. So the power intensity at this location is what? Total power by the total area multiplied by the area occupied by this, that is equal to what? 1. So hence power intensity is power coming out per unit area. That means if I'm transmitting with a power PT, what is the amount of power that I'm trying to get it from here? Why am I doing this? Is if I'm trying to deploy or if I'm trying to have a mobile handset here, how much amount of power that it is able to take it up? Okay, and from there I'm trying to find, find out the received power. Okay, so now I'm trying to find out, if this is a mobile handset at this location, I wanted to find out what is the received power, PR. Received power PR is equal to what? What is the total power that is coming out of this area? Power intensity, S. S multiplied by, multiplied by some quantity A. S into A, because whatever the total power that is coming out that out of that particular area, now whatever your receiving antenna that you have, okay, because I'm trying to find out received power at Y. That means I'm assuming that I'm putting up a mobile handset here. Definitely it will have some antenna, and a portion of that, okay, whatever is coming out from this is being taken by the receiving antenna. Okay, so hence whatever is the amount of power that is taken by the receiving antenna is equal to what? Total power that is coming out, power intensity multiplied by A, where A is effective aperture area of that particular receiving antenna. So whatever the antenna that you have some effective aperture antenna for that particular effective aperture area within which only it would be taking up, okay, the power. So received power at this location, PR, is equal to what? The power that is coming out, power coming out of this particular unit area, whatever the power that is coming out of this area, the portion of the power that is being captured by your receiving antenna. A represents the portion of the power that your receiving antenna is able to capture from this S. Hence S into A, and S, you know that S is nothing but what? PT by 4 pi r square. Okay, so this is what the received power at a mobile handset. Okay, now you can see that on a nutshell, if I'm trying to look at what I'm trying to do, is I'm trying to transmit with a power PT, and I'm assuming that the medium is lossless medium. Hence the total power that is coming out of this total area is PT by 4 pi r square. PT, total power is PT. Now I'm trying to find out the amount of power that is coming out per unit area, that is PT by 4 pi r square. Now out of this, whatever the power that is coming out of this area, when I'm putting a mobile handset, how much this mobile handset is in a position to take up? That is nothing but what? A portion, that is A. Hence received power is equal to what? S into A. That is equal to what? PT by 4 pi r square into A. Okay, this is one derivation. Now this is assuming the fact that I'm trying to consider an omnidirectional antenna. Omnidirectional means it radiates equally in all the direction. Now what is the, okay, what do you have if I have some directional antenna? If I have some directional antenna, what modification that you have for this particular receive power? That we will try to see. Power intensity for directional antennas. This is for omnidirectional antenna, which is radiating equally in all the directions. What we said, it is PT is the power with which if I'm trying to transmit, the power coming or the power intensity at this location, just now we have seen that is equal to what? S for omnidirectional is equal to what? PT by 4 pi r square. PT by 4 pi r square. This we have seen it just now. Let's extend that for directional antenna. Directional antenna means it is radiating only in this direction. Let us assume that the same power PT with the radius r, but it is radiating only in this direction. It is radiating only in this particular direction. Now we wanted to find out what is power coming out this particular unit area. What is the difference that I have? Previously total power PT was coming out of this complete area, and this area was 4 pi r square. But now this total power PT is coming out only this area. not this, because it is a directional antenna. Okay, approximately when I'm trying to look at the area occupied by this is nothing but what? The total area is 4 pi r square. Can you take this to be 1/3 of the total area? So hence, what modification that I have to do here? Transmission power is same, but only thing is, whatever the area previously it was 4 pi r square, but now 1/3 of your 4 pi r square. That if I am trying to consider for directional antenna, PT divided by 1/3 of 4 pi r square. Now this three term coming, okay, to the numerator, then what you get, it is PT by 4 pi r square, which is nothing but what? Power intensity of a directional antenna. Now you see the advantage. If I am using a directional antenna, power intensity for a directional antenna is equal to what? 3 times that of an omnidirectional antenna. And this 3 factor is what we call it as gain of the transmitting antenna. This 3 is what we call it as gain of the transmitting antenna. In more general, if I am trying to put it in mathematical way, directional antenna, power intensity for a directional antenna is equal to what? GT into omnidirectional. GT, where GT, G suffix T is what? Gain of the transmitting antenna. Or in other words, power received for a directional antenna is nothing but what? GT into power received for omnidirectional antenna. So further you can extend this. Further, one can extend this for omnidirectional antennas. Let's quickly finish up this case. In case of directional case, we said, now what is the power received? We said received power is equal to what? GT into, this is what? Power received by omnidirectional antenna. That is PT by 4 pi r square into A, or S into A. Where GT is the gain of the transmitting antenna, PT is the transmission power, and then A is the effective aperture area of receiving antenna. And there is some definitions. PT into GT, we call it as EIRP, effective isotropic radiated power. That means what is effectively how much it is being radiated. PT is the transmission power and GT is nothing but what? Gain of the transmitting antenna. So PT into GT is effectively called it as effective isotropic radiated power. And now I wanted to replace this effective aperture area by gain of the antenna, where gain of the receiving antenna is equal to what? 4 pi A by lambda square. This is with respect to your antennas. For any antenna, gain of that receiving antenna equal to 4 pi A by lambda square. So A equal to what? GR into lambda square by 4 pi. So I can put GR into lambda square by 4 pi. So what you get? 4 pi square, okay, 4 pi R whole square, and then you'll get that lambda square PT GT into GR. So this is the overall expression that you have. Received power, received power equal to what? PT, transmitting antenna power, multiplied by the gain of the transmitting antenna, multiplied by the gain of the receiving antenna, divided by this factor. This factor we call it as path loss. 4 pi r by lambda square. 4 pi r by lambda square. Hence, I am putting this separately. Path loss equal to what? 4 pi r by lambda whole square. And suppose if this, if I am trying to put it in terms of dB, received power in dB, 10 log of everything if I am trying to make. You'll get received power equal to what? PT plus GT plus GR minus L. Okay, this is the derivation in case of received power in case of free space. In case of free space, and you can see here, ultimately from this, what is that I am trying to consider? It is received power. Now from this expression, what is that I am getting? Received power. Okay, transmission power is constant, gain of the transmitting antenna is constant, gain of the receiving antenna is constant that I am trying to consider. Okay, lambda is the frequency with which you are trying to transmit, or okay, 1 by f by c. And you can see that r is the distance, okay, which is what you can see that received power is inversely proportional to square of the distance. Received power is inversely proportional to square of the distance. This is what I hope we have used it in the previous class. And this is what the major thing that we have. Received power is inversely proportional to square of the distance. That means as the distance increases, received power decreases. This I hope we have already used it. and we will try to make use of this. And again, make sure that this is only for free space. Okay, let me stop here. And probably the cellular case, okay, you will get it r power n, that we will try to see it in the next class. Okay, these things, I hope interference and these things probably will try to see it in the next class. So let me stop.